Hi, this is Larry Huppin. I'm a medical consultant at ProLab Orthotics, and today we're going to look at an introduction to evidence-based orthotic therapy and tissue stress theory. This talk is actually an introduction to many of our other webinars, which review how to write orthotic prescriptions for specific pathologies. So here's our plan today. The first thing we're going to do is just look for a few minutes at how do you think about writing orthotic prescriptions and trying to consider where your goals are when you're writing an orthotic prescription in order to give your patient the best potential clinical outcome. Then we'll take a couple minutes and look at the idea of tissue stress theory in writing these prescriptions. And then as we go through some samples today, we're going to look at some of the evidence that's available. And these are really the two tenets we're going to use to write the prescription. Is looking at tissue stress theory, number one, and then number two is looking at what evidence is available to guide us in how to best write these orthotic prescriptions. And then finally, we're going to come up with an orthotic prescription. We'll do a sample today. But the idea is to look at how do we do this on every prescription that we're writing. So the first thing when we talk about goals, I actually have a quote here from Kevin Kirby, which I think explains it very well. So he said that the goal of foot orthosis therapy should be to, number one, reduce the pathologic loading forces on the injured structural components of the body, to allow healing of the injured structures, to prevent injuries from occurring, and to promote more efficient dynamics of the body during weight-bearing activities. So everything we're doing today and everything we should be doing when we write prescriptions should be focused on accomplishing these four items. So we're going to talk now about the idea of the tissue stress model or tissue stress theory in writing orthotic prescriptions. And the idea here is we're going to determine which forces are acting on the foot or on other parts of the body, and then trying to determine what those forces are, determine what we're going to do in an orthotic device to try and reverse those damaging forces. And there's really only three types of forces that we need to worry about. One is tension, the other is compression or pressure, and the third one is shear or friction. So let's look at this a little closer. So this was first described as far as foot orthoses go by McPoyle and Hunt back in 1995. And this is an excellent paper that I think anyone that is active in orthotic therapy should have read. They were at the time using standard root measurements when writing orthotic prescriptions, but actually found those to be fairly unreliable and not particularly reproducible. I think it's important to note they did not consider their theory original at all. This idea of the tissue stress model was used in bracing the body in other parts of the body for years. For example, somebody with medial knee osteoarthritis, the idea would be to use a brace to open up the medial knee. And so this is the idea they tried to apply to foot orthoses, and that they came up with an examination and management protocol that was based on just identifying what the stress was that was damaging the foot and that causes injury, and then eliminating that stress. Right? So let's look at this. And they based this based on something called the load deformation curve, meaning identifying where the foot or where the tissue of the body is about to get injured and stopping it from getting to that point. But rather than have me explain this, I actually found a video of Tom McPoyle, so I think we will have him explain that himself.
In 1995, my colleague Gary Hunt and I published a paper in which we presented the tissue stress model. The purpose of that tissue stress model was to try to provide the clinician with a different paradigm in which to treat the foot and ankle. And we based the tissue stress model on the load deformation curve. The tissue stress model is based on the load deformation curve. And as you can see in this graph, there are two ranges, an elastic range, which represents the normal give and take of soft tissues and muscle tissues as we undergo typical activities such as running and walking. And then you can also see that we have a plastic range. If the tissues enter into the plastic range, of course, that is going to mean permanent deformation of the tissues, like when you suffer an ankle sprain. You'll notice that the zone separating the elastic range and the plastic range is referred to as the microfailure zone. If we cannot keep
the tissues as they're undergoing stress or being moved during different activities, if we cannot keep those tissues within the elastic range and they begin to enter into the microfailure zone, what will now happen is an increase in not only tissue deformation but also stress. The purpose of using the load deformation curve to explain the tissue stress model is to provide the understanding that when we have a patient who has increased stress to soft tissues and muscle-related tissues, one of the purposes of our orthotic device as part of the comprehensive management program is to control the amount of deformation that the tissues are entering to try to keep them from going into this microfailure zone. So if we pull over this model, here again, as the person is undergoing a certain amount of pronation, we know that each person has to undergo a certain amount of pronation for normal movement. Our interest as clinicians is trying to determine when do we have excessive pronation or too much pronation. It's that excessive pronation that now causes the individual to enter into the microfailure zone with regards to tissue stress and deformation, which leads to symptoms. It makes sense then, the purpose of our orthotic device is to try to control how much movement the foot goes into pronation in an attempt to control the stress and deformation that are placed on the tissues.
All right, so our thanks to Tom McPoyle, and I do recommend you read his paper. All right, so let's look at the tenets of tissue stress theory. The first thing that you need to do is identify the structure that's injured or symptomatic. So let's just say again, it's the plantar fascia. Then determine what's the most likely type of abnormal tissue stress that's causing the pathology. Well, with plantar fasciosis or plantar fasciitis, it's tension on that fascia. Next thing we want to do is try and prescribe an orthotic device that's going to reduce that abnormal tissue stress. So what do we need to think about when writing that prescription to best take tension off that fascia? And we won't talk about that specifically now, but I would refer you to our webinar on plantar fasciitis treatment with orthotic therapy in order to see how to do that and even a number of the studies that are available to show us the most effective way to accomplish that. So that's the idea of tissue stress. Now let's take an example here of metatarsalgia. And obviously metatarsalgia can mean a number of different things. It could be capsulitis, it could be neuroma, it could be a neuropathic ulceration, forefoot pain associated with RA, painful keratomas. A lot of things will cause pain under the ball of the foot. So let's look at our orthotic goals for treating pain under the ball of the foot. And we really have two here, depending on exactly what's going on. Regardless, we want to decrease pressure, right? So our first tenet of tissue stress theories, identify what force is causing the problem. In this case, it will be pressure. But there's some case or causes of pain under the ball of the foot that also have a friction component. Those would include callus, blister, and ulceration. So to reduce forefoot pressure, I've got five suggested orthotic modifications. And what you'll notice here is almost all of these here, we do have evidence to back up what we are trying to accomplish. So not only can we use tissue stress theory to figure out what exactly we're trying to accomplish with these orthoses, but we can fine-tune that prescription by recognizing that in many cases there is evidence that points the direction to go and maybe gives us even better detail on how to write that prescription. So we know here that we want to at least use a non-deforming material, something that's fairly rigid, and that softer materials don't have as much ability to transfer pressure. This was shown by Chalmers in 2000. He was doing a study on patients with RA and looking at pain levels, and he found that semi-rigid orthoses had significant effect on pain, where soft orthoses or shoes only did not. Now, the material choice itself, we'll leave up to the specific practitioner. It could be polypropylene, it could be graphite. There's a lot of ways to make a fairly rigid orthosis, but the key is that it be resistant to deformation. The second is have it conform very close to the arch of the foot, and Mueller in 2006 was working with diabetic patients and found that a device that can form close to the arch of the foot was effective in transferring pressure off of the ball of the foot. He noted that total contact insert, it reduces excessive pressure at the med heads by essentially increasing the contact area force farther back on the arch. So you'll notice here, this device conforms very close to the arch while this one gaps. In order to best transfer pressure off of the metatarsal heads, we want to see that close contour to the arch. We can also get close contour to the arch by making sure we're doing an appropriate negative cast, subtalar joint neutral, metatarsal joint lock, but also plantar flexing the first ray to enhance the arch height. That will result in an orthosis that also conforms closer to the arch. And then prescribing a minimum cast fill, meaning rather than this one here where there's a lot of fill in the medial arch, it will be this one back here where there's a very minimum amount of fill. That will make for an orthosis that conforms very close to the arch of the foot. Now, these are obviously old plaster cast. Most of the cast work now is done on CAD/CAM computer, but the same idea applies. You're going to want to ask for a minimum fill, and with that, you're going to want to make sure that your lab does not overfill the arch. So if you have prescribed a minimum fill, and then you have that orthotic back, and you hold it back up to the patient's foot, with that foot in that casting position, you should find that that arch conforms close to the arch of the foot. To get even closer, even a closer contour, you can invert the negative cast a little bit. And you're going to have to figure out with your own lab what that means. I mean, with our lab, minimum fill is very close to the arch of the foot. That might be different elsewhere, but you should understand what exact prescription you need to get that really tight fill and that really tight contour to the arch of the foot. The next thing is you can use metatarsal bars, which is this here, a piece of poron that is placed on top of the orthosis, less full thickness distally and beveled proximally. Or you can use a metatarsal pad. Hastings actually did a study and found that met pads that were placed between 6.1 millimeters and 10.6 millimeters proximal to the met head resulted in significant peak plantar pressure reduction compared to wearing that total contact insert only. So while the total contact insert was effective, doing so with that well-placed metatarsal pad was even more so. It was even more effective, and this was another study looking at metatarsal pad placement. Landorf in 2014 did a study where he had four types of pads and a control. So the first pad was placed 10 millimeters proximal to the med head. The second pad 5 millimeters distal. That's the distal edge we're talking about. He had the metatarsal bar and then what he called a plantar cover, which is really a metatarsal bar with cushioning under the metatarsal heads. And this is what he found is that there was, with the metatarsal pad placed more proximally, there was a 9% reduction in peak plantar pressure. With the metatarsal bar, 10% reduction. With the more distally placed metatarsal pad, a 17% reduction. And with the plantar cover, there was a 19% reduction. Now, what would have been interesting is to see the combination of this pad plus poron extension under the metatarsal head. So with that, we are going to recommend also that poron extension under the metatarsal heads. We also recommend if you're going to use any of these pads, glue your top cover posterior only so you can easily adjust the location of that pad because it is somewhat subjective where patients are going to like it to be placed. So this might be a good device, assuming that this is a good contour to the arch. We've got a metatarsal bar, we have a poron extension, cover glued posterior only, and hopefully a really close contour to the arch. So again, using tissue stress theory, we really can come up with the idea of what we want to accomplish, which is to transfer pressure, and then using the available evidence, we can fine-tune it to get the best device possible. Now, again, this is the pressure portion. We also have to reduce friction in many cases. Currently, it's really tough to measure friction, and so it's often ignored during treatment. And most of the materials that we use for covers and cushioning on orthoses really have a fairly high coefficient of friction, and all of them tend to increase in their coefficient of friction when they get wet. There is one material on the market that you can use to decrease friction locally, and that's polytetrafluoroethylene. This is a basically a medical grade Teflon. It was developed initially actually as a suture and as a vascular graft because of its very low coefficient of friction. You could use it on fragile structures without injuring it. But it's actually been also put on the market as a class one medical device, as a patch to go onto orthotic devices and onto shoes. It has a very, very low coefficient of friction. All over here and over here we have the other common top cover materials, but PTFE has a very low coefficient of friction compared to those other materials. And even when it gets wet, it's the only material that does not have an increased coefficient of friction. So if you're looking to treat, let's say, either a callus or an ulceration, then using the what we just talked about previously to decrease the pressure component and then using a PTFE patch to decrease the friction component really uses that tissue stress theory along with the available evidence to give us our best possible orthotic prescription. Here's some samples of the PTFE patch and where it might be applied. Again, another idea of how you might apply it and what you might apply it for. So the summary for this portion here on the metatarsalgias, you're going to get the optimum outcomes for metatarsal pain if you decrease forefoot pressure and you decrease forefoot friction. Again, that's identifying which of those forces are causing the problem and then going from there. I think it's also important to note that you can use these same theories on almost any pathology affecting the foot or any pathology affecting the body that is affected by the foot, right? So that might be plantar fasciitis or plantar fasciosis. Here we probably want to decrease tension on the plantar fascia, hallux limitus and hallux valgus, decrease compression within the first MPJ, tarsal tunnel syndrome is decreased tarsal tunnel pressure and tarsal nerve tension. If it's DJD of the midfoot, you'll probably be focused on trying to decrease midfoot motion at the joints that have the osteoarthritis, and posterior tibial tendonitis, reduce tension on the posterior tibialis. So you can actually go to our website, to prolaborthotics.com, and you can find webinars on all of those pathologies along with other information on treating those pathologies. Right listed here are some other websites that have excellent information on foot orthotic therapy and biomechanics in general. There's also a couple books listed up here that are excellent. If you want to write these down, just pause the video and do so. So that is it on our introduction. If you have any questions, please contact us. ProLabOrthotics.com, or you can email us at CS, that's for customer service, CS@ProLab-USA.com.